Think of all the crazy bone-crunching crashes of fists and feet that you can find in the history of Mortal Kombat. You can see just about anything happening in this eternal tournament, but there's arguably one move that is the most iconic, an uppercut that sends an opponent skyward. This incredibly powerful punch is a mainstay of modern fighting games and pop culture in general, but what would it really take?
Are we gonna do like a big thing for this, or?
Alright. Well, what would it really take?
No! Oh, 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 release me!
No!
No!
Please!
No!
Help me!
Oh,
that was good!
Okay!
Kill for me! Defend my honor! Wow! That was great! You've earned one treat. What would it really take to do a move like that? This is the science of Mortal Kombat. Welcome to my Mortal Kombat version of the Void, complete with a legion of minions ready to do my sciencey bidding, and entire areas dedicated to the overanalysis of kicking and punching. In today's episode, we are covering maybe the most famous move in all of Mortal Kombat, the classic uppercut. You've seen the uppercut in Mortal Kombat games for decades now, and of course, it returns in the latest entry into the series, Mortal Kombat 11 from Warner Brothers and NetherRealm Studios. It is typified not just by a punch that is strong, but a punch that has so much force behind it that it lifts an opponent up into the air and above the puncher's head. Our mission today is to test whether or not a humanoid fighter can really punch this hard. But if one of my minions can't handle it, then we'll have to figure out some kind of way to replicate what we see in the game. What? You haven't done anything yet. You don't get a treat. This isn't how this works. Get out of here. Leave. Go away! You would not believe the treat budget around here. Look, I'm not gonna pull any punches here. A Mortal Kombat-style uppercut does not have physics in its favor. If you wanted to lift a fighter off of the ground with an uppercut alone, you're gonna have to supply a substantial force to their face with your fist. At minimum, that force you apply to their face is gonna have to equal their weight, which is the mass of the fighter multiplied by the acceleration due to gravity on whatever planet they're on. If there's some force left over, some resultant force, after these two forces interact, then in accordance with smart boy Isaac Newton's second law, they will accelerate in that direction in accordance with their mass flawlessly. To estimate the uppercutting forces that we need, we can assume that the uppercutted fighter travels in an arc like a projectile would. Then I went back and I looked at all the Mortal Kombat footage over the years, and it looks to me like the average uppercut launches another fighter at around an 80 degree angle, 1.5 body lengths or so off of the ground, and it takes about a second for the bodies to hit the floor. Using all this information and plugging it into some of the equations for projectile motion, you find that to conform to this arc, a fighter needs to be hit with enough force to give them an initial velocity of 7 meters per second, or 15 miles an hour. 7 meters per second isn't a crazy with a K velocity, but it would still require quite a bit of force. If a fighter is going to be lifting someone off of the ground with an uppercut, they are doing work on that other fighter, defined as applying a force from their fist across some distance, their face. And work can also be defined as the change in kinetic energy for an object. So using that, we can plug in our initial velocity from our projectile motion equations and start assuming a range of distances that the fist crosses another fighter's face in order to get a range of force values. And when we do that, we have to do the final move first, which is forward, back punch. No, it was forward, back, back, punch. There we go. If we do that, we get a range of force values that's somewhere between 5,000 and 15,000 newtons, thousands of pounds of force. Now, not only is this range out of the range of any validated punching numbers I could find for a real human, all of this is assuming that a human is perfectly rigid, like a point mass. But a human is not a point mass, they're a flexible body. When you actually uppercut someone's face, their head is gonna move around and their neck is gonna extend and their skin is gonna get all weird like in those videos on the internet that you see. So it would probably take even more force than we see. So, a Mortal Kombat uppercut is implausible at best, but hey, we're still being theoretical here. Let's test it ourselves. For today's testing, I've enlisted the help of science YouTuber, super nerd, and friend Alan Pan. Hello, Alan. This is upsetting.
Hi, Kyle.
So what do we got?
This is a ballistics gel head, and it's got a material inside that his skull and his spine are made out of that have a similar strength to actual human bone. And he also has this sort of rubbery flesh that has similar impact characteristics to actual human flesh.
That will be perfect. And this whole stand, I'm assuming, is gonna be person-y?
So this stand is to make sure that he's at the correct height, and most importantly, we have weights on this stand so that he weighs about as much as a person weighs.
Sure, because the important thing here is to see not just what happens to the head, neck, and face, but if you can do the physical work to lift their weight off of the ground.
Exactly.
Okay, well, I'm gonna get my more punchy minions to try punching this thing. So here is our experimental setup for the human-powered test. As Alan said, we have our analog head, and now it is on a stand that is accurately weighted for a beef boy. But if we really want to test if a human can do this, lift our test subjects off the ground, we're thinking you can uppercut a real person off the ground. But if we want a real person to do that, we need someone who's used to punching heads. So, Void, send me my most experienced minion in punching heads, please. Oh.
Oh, hey.
Hey, it's world famous mixed martial artist and professional wrestler CM Punk. How long have you been here?
Since MK1.
Oh no. We have stuff to talk about later. But for now, you have a lot of experience punching people in the face.
Sure.
So what do you think your chances are with a full weighted setup and a head like this?
To get this thing 6 feet in the air?
Yeah, over your head.
My chances aren't good. I'm hoping I can at least chip a tooth.
Well, the floor is yours.
All right.
Round one.
Whoa, I would not want to get hit like that.
He moved a little bit.
But did not move up in the air. How did that feel?
Felt good, felt solid. Just actually being able to lift the mass off the ground, I think it's gonna be impossible.
I think this might actually be impossible for mere mortals such as we, so I'm gonna bring in what I call the Fist of Doom.
All right, I'm gonna leave for that.
Okay, yeah, let's go.
All right.
Hey, do you think I could do some MMA stuff?
You know, if you try really hard, probably not.
Oh, thanks. I think we're gonna have to ramp it way up, so what do you got?
Just the thing, this.
No.
Okay, plan B.
Sure.
The Fist of Doom.
That's legitimately impressive.
Thank you.
What is that gonna do?
This is a punching piston. It's running at about 170 PSI, and it can punch with a force of nearly 3,000 pounds.
Nearly 3,000 pounds. That's perfect because it falls right within the range that we previously calculated. So if, you know, the head doesn't come straight off of this thing, it might lift up some amount?
Maybe.
Yeah, okay, well, you finish the Fist of Doom.
Can do.
Alan, our minion punched valiantly, but it wasn't quite the classic Mortal Kombat uppercut, so how is the Fist of Doom gonna do better?
Well, we're going to fully pressurize our air tank, and then after getting a safe distance away, we're gonna activate that punching piston with this switch and this battery.
Yeah, better be safe when this thing goes up. And we still have our weighted dummy accurately, 80 kilograms, just so we can see what the perfect application of force does to it, but what do you think is gonna happen?
Well, it's a ton of force that we have, but just like a real body, our dummy has a little bit of a flop to him. Mm-hmm. So I think there's a good chance that rather than getting punched up, he might just get punched back.
All right, well, you get to a safe distance while I do the same.
Round two.
Okay. Punching machine is armed. Fist of Doom firing in 3, 2, 1.
Okay.
I don't think we got airborne.
Oh, really? What gave that away? Yeah, but it does look like our entire stand shattered in the back.
Yeah, we pulled out the wood screws down here entirely.
Yeah, that's not easy to do, but we still did not get any liftoff like we see in Mortal Kombat.
Yeah, you know, I'm noticing now that we put all of the weight that a human body would have at the bottom here, and that might have created sort of like an artificial pivot point that encouraged him to get knocked back like this rather than up.
Yeah, my feet don't weigh 80 kilograms. So maybe redistributing the mass closer to where the center of mass of a person would be. Sorry, CM. The Fist of Doom, how could that change?
You know, underneath that boxing glove is just a solid block of aluminum.
Okay, so if it was more rigid, then more force would transfer more quickly to the face. Huh. You saying the gloves are coming off?
I think the gloves are coming off.
Round three.
Fist of Doom firing in 3, 2, 1.
Okay. Okay, so, still not airborne.
No.
We did everything that we possibly could, and I think looking at the high speed, It's the flexing of the neck.
We did manage to punch this guy about as hard as you could ever possibly hope to punch a guy.
The neck is flexing so much that the force is going into translating motion into the neck and not lifting straight up. Humans are floppy things. This is kind of what would happen. I mean, looking at him more closely, I do see some damage underneath the neck. I see kind of a big gash across where the jugular would be.
Yeah, his throat got split open in a couple places.
Yay.
It's still floppy.
Why is his head so... Oh, Alan, look at this. Look at this. That is a full spinal fracture right across where, I believe this is where your spinal cord would be. It snapped his neck before it lifted him half an inch off the ground. This is a fatality, my friend. So I think we've done pretty much all we can do in this setup. How can we make this uppercut work?
We've made the fist harder. Mm-hmm. We've made the body stiffer. We've given this every possible chance.
Yeah.
I think the only thing left to do if we want to replicate what we see in the game and try and get a body to fly 2 meters in the air or whatever is just to make this guy super light. It might look kind of weird.
I'm fine with it.
Okay,
okay.
Let's do it. Fist of Doom firing in 3, 2, 1.
Finish him.
Yes, Alan, get over here. We did it.
I think that was perfect replication.
Yeah, if you look at the footage, it looks just like it does in Mortal Kombat, but what did we have to do just to make that happen?
Well, first of all, we had to create a gigantic punching machine that can punch way harder than any mortal man could.
And then we had to make a special inflatable dummy that weighed 10 to 15 times less than what we had been using.
And then, just to make sure that all that energy actually transferred into him, we had to give him this outrageous chin extension.
And we had to add a guiding rod like he was some kind of water bottle rocket just so the force wouldn't push him away when he was punched.
Kyle.
Yeah?
I don't think you can punch a guy into the air.
Alan, I'm really glad we replicated this, but I don't think you can punch a guy into the air. This is awesome though. We set out to test today whether or not it truly was possible to uppercut someone so hard that they lifted off the ground, and I think we've shown that that's pretty much impossible. Even if you had the theoretical amount of force behind your fist to lift someone, humans are squishy, bendy things, and most of that force is gonna go into either moving the head out of the way or moving the neck so far back that you cause a fatality before the other fighter even hits the ground, kind of defeating the point. So, this move has to stay in the Mortal Kombat universe. Until next time, I'll see...
For me? Thank you.
I'll see you in the void.
Coming up next on the Science of Mortal Kombat.
It is the heat of Scorpion's chain which allows him to pull it through a person. So what we are going to do today is try our best to replicate the conditions of this heated fatality to see what they do to our human flesh analog. Yeah.
Heated chain test. In 3, 2, 1.
Oh no!